Hello, dear friends. Digital Ship Webinar is back, and today we're excited to present you a real-life story using HoloLens in maritime maintenance that the Dutch heavy lift company Jumbo has actually tried. Our guest speakers are key people of the project, and let me introduce you to them. Sita Verburg, Senior Project Engineer at Jumbo, Otto Savenier, Senior Project Engineer and Senior Port Captain, also from Jumbo, and finally, Joost van Schaik, experienced mixed reality developer. We are thankful to Jumbo, who is sponsoring this webinar, and we encourage you to be very active in Q&A session. And now we are starting off with Carl's insights into the topic.
Okay, thank you, Vida. So this is something we've heard a lot about for the last sort of 20 years or so, augmented and mixed reality and how we can use it in shipping. And this idea, you have something from the virtual world and you put it on top of the real world. So to give you some examples of how you can use it, you've got a delivery driver trying to find your letterbox. He can have something on his screen showing where your letterbox is. You've got a maintenance technician trying to do some work. He can have something that shows him which valve he should turn, or it can tell him what's going on inside some machinery he can't see. We've seen augmented reality tour guides that give you information about some church you're looking at on a screen. There's two ways you can do it technically. So maybe the most straightforward way is if you've got a cell phone, so it's got a video on one side that's looking at reality, and you're looking at the screen, you see the video of reality on your screen, plus you've got the digital data on top of the screen. So that's one way to do it, but you've got to look at your mobile phone for that to work. A more sophisticated way to do it is with wearable glasses. So you've got these wearable glasses, which are kind of transparent, but you've got some digital information showing on them as a screen. So you can see there's some very difficult technical challenges apart from the data side of it. So from the technical point of view, you've got to get the digital information exactly in the right place on top of the real world information. So maybe you're doing that with some video analytics, so the computer's understanding the video, or maybe you're doing it with GPS and accelerometers, so the computer knows where you're looking. But if you lose the alignment just a little bit, the whole thing doesn't work. And that's one of the biggest challenges. But bearing all of this in mind, so what we've got today is, I think, is the first story of using mixed reality in a real world shipping industry that I've actually heard about. We're going to the world of heavy lift ships. We're going to Schiedam, which is between Hook of Holland and Rotterdam. So these are ships that take big oil and gas equipment or big subsea cables across the water. Now, the equipment needs to be put in a very precise place on the deck. That's for structural reasons. So you calculate where you can put that on the deck so the ship can hold it. And the normal way of doing it is you have a device that paints lines on the deck of the ship. So that's a bit like a device for painting running track on grass. So it can take a few hours, up to a few hours to put these lines on the deck. So Jumbo thought maybe we can do this with a augmented reality, so you see the lines of where to put the equipment in people's glasses rather than actually having to paint it on the deck. So we're going to find out today how it all went. So first we've got Sita Verburg, who's a senior project engineer at Jumbo, who she came up with the idea in the first place. We have Joost van Schaik, who's he's from the software development point of view. He'll talk about how that worked. And finally we've got Otto Savenea, who's a project engineer and senior port captain at Jumbo, who supervises the project, and he'll tell you about what the real world results were. And as with all our webinars, we should have lots of time for questions, so please load them in the Q&A box. So I'd like to invite Sita to give the opening talk. Thank you.
Thank you, Carl, for the introduction. I'll share my presentation. So, I'm indeed a project engineer at Jumbo, and I was also part of the innovation team because, within Jumbo, the management had some instructions, and actually, do you still see my screen?
Yeah.
Okay. The management instruction was to make innovation a bigger part of the company, and that's why we have the innovation team, and they also wanted to start with something with virtual reality. The first ideas were, quite fancy. How to perhaps we can simulate the whole loading in the tender, for example. But then I thought, why should we start off so difficult? Maybe it's good to start easy, something very simple, like an overlay for to position cargo on deck, just so you can see, like with a dia projector, where you would have to draw the lines for the footprint of the cargo. Well, why is that handy? That's because, for example, in this deck layout, here you see the top view of one of our vessels. And as you can see, the cargo, it's under an angle, and there are a few tween decks on top of the deck, also various places, and one under an angle. It's very crowded. So in these kind of situations for the complex deck layouts, it would be really handy to have just an overlay drawing, because otherwise you'll spend hours and hours of measuring where to put this and then remeasure. Did I exactly have the correct location? Yeah, okay. So that's why for especially the complex cargoes, it would be handy for and speeding up the process, but also for being accurate. Well, how should we do that? Because what is the right mixed reality tool? So actually we set out requirements, first being accuracy, because even though our vessels are very big, 100, 150 meters, we want the cargo positioned well within a few centimeters, and sometimes even a centimeter accuracy is required. Then secondly, the safety on board. It needs to be see-through, because there are many slips and trips on a vessel, D-rings, other items, maybe already lashings were prepared on the deck. So there's a lot of stuff lying around. Then it should be able to deal with environmental conditions. We operate everywhere in the world. So sun, humidity, rain, cold, heat. Is the device capable to deal with that? And also one of the most important things is that it should be able to work without an internet connection. We can make connection on the bridge to download the drawings on the device. But afterwards, when you go out on the deck, it should be able to work standalone. So we did a lot of trying and testing. And in the meantime, Joost and his colleagues were developing and also struggling. Well, Joost will tell you all about it later, but apparently my simple idea is not so simple to engineer. And one of the questions that came up is, how do you know that the drawing is projected accurate? Well, for that, the answer is actually, well, again, quite simple. We have to project also the details of the hatch covers or of the tank top within the drawing. So on the middle picture, you can actually see one of the lifting points of the hatches. It is spot on. And on the top right draw picture, you see one of the D-rings. Well, actually, in the picture, it's flapped up, and in real life, it's flapped down. Well, that we cannot take into account, of course. And the right lower picture shows very clearly a manhole, which is not on the correct spot of the manhole. So for that one, you know, I really have to adjust the position of my drawing, which you can do on site. So this was one of the main questions. And then how does the final drawing look like, which we make? Well, I've got two examples. So basically what it comes down to is that the deck marker sees the footprint of the cargo projected on the deck. And that's here in magenta. Not only the cargo is projected, as I said, also the details of the deck and also the frames. That's important for the structural point of view. And it's also very easy to check on board. You can use a hammer or shackle, whatever, just to hear where the frame is and if it is where it should be. The colors we used also came out from a lot of testing, and it appears that most people see magenta best projected on our green decks. It looks like here that the background is black, but actually within the HoloLens, the background black is see-through. So this is see-through. Then for the right picture, I chose another way. I have here the really used shimming plates. So those I showed in gray with the number, and then in magenta, the outline indeed. And these are just two examples. In that case, we're still in a little bit of trying what are people's preferences to have exactly on drawings. So I'm sure that in due time, when we have much more experience, we will also make this more standardized. So that's basically what the engineers prepare and what they will send through our system, which Joost will explain later. And then how it looks like in real life. Well, this is a bit of how it could look like. One of the officers who is kneeling, he's actually drawing out the lines. He's drawing now in green. And he can also see the white. But his colleague, he cannot see the white. He can only see what the officer on his knees has already drawn. So that's the general general idea. And this is basically what it comes down to. And it sounds quite simple. So now I'd like to pass on the word to Joost to explain why it was not so simple.
Thank you, Sita. Yeah, indeed, it was not so simple, but it was very exciting. So I will now try to share my screen. Can you see my screen? No, I don't think you can yet, because I first have to share the screen. Screen two, share. That should work.
Yeah, I think it's working. Yeah.
Better. Okay, I'm Joost van Schaik. You see Microsoft, but I'm not working for Microsoft. This is purely an honorary title for people who spend too much time and sharing knowledge about various Microsoft techniques, for instance, HoloLens, and for instance, doing webinars. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the technique, the tools, how we wrestled and achieved accuracy, how we dealt with what were essentially 2D drawings in a 3D environment, how we dealt with out of scope usage. HoloLens is meant to function within an indoor environment. And obviously a ship doesn't fit in that. How we worked with heat humidity, how we did something about user and usability and engagement. And of course the whole integration story that Sita just already touched upon. So the tools are simple. For developing the graphics, we used Unity. Unity is a gaming engine, and for the code side, we used Microsoft Visual Studio. So here was I working, building development, doing enterprise development in a gaming environment. One of the first things we noticed was that the version of Unity and the version of the software on the HoloLens were very critical to achieving the desired accuracy. So that was problem one to solve. Accuracy over large distances. Basically, we defined per deck plate 2 points, point port aft and starboard forward. I actually learned some shipping words during the project. Well, basic math will then give you the rotation of the actual deck and its scale, because the drawing is not is to scale, but needs to be stretched to fit over the scale. You need to scan the environment first. You need to walk slowly around the deck, because otherwise we don't know what to see. The HoloLens is designed for indoor use. Its scanning range is about 3 meters, but it can remember where it's been and extrapolate where stuff that it already has seen must be. So we needed to find out how it work over large distances. And what we found was that a visual clutter works. If you see this deck, you will see the middle deck doesn't work that well. It's very, everything looks the same. Actually, the HoloLens only has good feedback where the wood is and where the railing is. The decks on the front with the yellow, whatever it is, that worked pretty well because there's also rust and flakes on it. And on the other, the background, the back deck is even better, but there is so much stuff on it that you hardly can deck mark. What we also found, and my colleague who is not here discovered it, was using tiled display. Instead of trying to draw the whole drawing, we cut it in tiles and showed the only pieces of it near you, like Google Maps. And what we call this the Billie Jean method, and I will show you why. Because this is the clip of Billie Jean. You will see Michael Jackson walking, and where he walks, the stuff appears. Well, this is exactly what appeared while we were doing that. You see the map is appearing like in tiles, and you cannot, you see here the magenta stuff, you can only deck mark so far away, your arms aren't 3 meters long anyway. So that worked perfectly fine. Then we had the following thing. It's a 2D drawing on a deck. So how hard can it be? Because a drawing is flat, a ship deck is flat, so it's easy. Well, not that easy because, a ship isn't always upright, as this here software developer found. And that has several reasons. Loading cranes are in operation. I was actually on the deck and was, why is my drawing sinking into the deck? Well, that was simply because the loading crane was moving and it was carrying some not even that heavy load. Really, really big vehicles are used to transport load and all kinds of other stuff on the ship. And it may be it being in the process of loading, so it may be temporary uneven loaded. So you need to be the position not only in 2D on the deck, but also in 3D in space. So the drawing can be rotated like this with the ship healing. It's not automatically, so if the ship indeed heals heavily, then you need to move the markers, the virtual markers, to fit with the deck. That may be a future improvement. Outdoor use. Well, we couldn't really, we could clearly define ways in which it did not work. A very, very bright sunlight, like in the tropics, wildly varying lighting conditions. For instance, if you have like quickly moving clouds, well, you're in trouble because the HoloLens sees the picture change too fast. Well, excessive heat and excessive humidity is also a problem. But since you don't need to deck mark the whole day because the process is so fast, you can first use sunshades. It's really simple. If you have a HoloLens like this, you can really simply, I hope you can see it, just put some dark stuff around it. You can still see the holograms and the environment, and you're done. You can use it during dusk or dawn because in the tropics, it's still then very light and you only need a couple of hours anyway. And I've seen the ship, the Jumbo ship, carry a huge flashlight, a floodlight, so you can even do it at night if you want. And it takes only a couple of hours. About usability, well, we have a new device here with a new interaction model. So people have no idea how to use it. So we need to get users on board, and this is pun intended, and engaged. Now, fortunately, a lot of people at Jumbo are very forward-looking. And I actually walked up on the ship, and there was this, he looked like a pirate in the personal protection gear. And he said, I looked at me and was like, when is this stuff ready? I would love to use it. I was like, okay. What you also need to do is test, and test more, and especially to get users to test as well in every stage, because one of our port captains, Hank, discovered a very typical bug that we got some reports from Singapore that the menus sometimes didn't work. And he was the only one who could actually make that happen before my eyes. And what you basically do, if you press a button on the whole lens, you do this, tap. But if you do this just a little slower, it registers a different event, pinch. The difference is like in milliseconds, but he was the only one who actually got to pull it off. So it was like things like that that could take enormous amount of time. Also important, get out there yourself. This is me on board of one of the ships. I don't actually remember which one. And I also did a lot of testing on the parking place of the company I worked back for then. And yeah, these oranges and other stuff are, well, I can't see a real deck. So I had to set one out with a very large tape measure that was specially bought for it. And then, of course, you have to take into account all the people asking what the hell you're doing. So, okay, lots of testing on all places in all kinds of environments and lighting conditions. Then the end-to-end integration, because as Sita just says, said, engineers work at the jumbo offices and the ships are somewhere, and that may be anywhere actually better in the world, have intermittent internet connection and no Wi-Fi at the desks. So what happens? Sita and her friends make the drawing in Jumbo in Schiedam, and the drawing is split into tiles using the Jumbo DMS, and then uploaded to Microsoft OneDrive. This is a cloud file system, and it actually more uses, in this case, the cloud is literally above the clouds because it uses a satellite connection. Well, then there is the ship somewhere, and it uses a satellite connection to download the stuff to OneDrive. This may go very slowly. It doesn't really matter. The main thing is if it's ready before the actual deck marking starts. Then the deck marking engineer simply connects the HoloLens to the Wi-Fi on the bridge, downloads the fix, as they call it, on the HoloLens, and goes out to the deck marking without any Wi-Fi connection. And as Otto will show, it actually works. This was basically the story I had to tell. I can tell lots more because, but otherwise, I think people want to ask questions as well. Only one closing remark. I found it a very, very nice project. I mean, which software developer actually gets to walk over very large ships? And usually when you're a software developer, your view is a screen. And this was what I looked when I looked at the site. So I wish to thank Jumbo for giving me the opportunity to join them on this wonderful journey. And this was my presentation, and I'd like to hand over to Otto, who will show us something of the practical application of this whole story. Otto, take it away.
Yeah, Joost, thank you very much. I'll start sharing my screen now. And indeed, I would like to show now an example for a project that we did in September, October last year, showing really good the benefits and the advantage of using the HoloLens. The project that I chose is for positioning of a carousel, including a grillage on the deck of our ship. First, quickly explain for the carousel what it is, this picture. It's like a big cable reel placed on the deck. The weight can go up to 2,000, 3,000 tons. So very clear that you'll need a very good load spreading and for the strength of the ship that everything stays intact. And another picture here, you see already the pipeline, the product being filled up. And in this case, the diameter of the reel was 24 meters. Very quickly, for the huge weight, load spreading will be very important. So what we have to do, first find all the strong points in the deck of the ship, the longitudinal and transverse girders, and then find all the strong points in the bottom structure in the grillage of the cargo. And at the intersection of those two points, that's where you can really support the cargo. But in this case, we do by shimming plates, what I show you later. One picture, an example, how such a grillage looks like for the big carousel.
see all the beams. And at the end, if you intersect those two, you get a drawing, something like this, with all the frames and girders of the deck. And then the circle in the blue lines, you see the outline, the footprint of the cargo, and all the intersection points, but we indicated in purple, magenta, all the intersection points where we want to put a shimming plate. And you see a lot of dimension lines. So you can imagine if you have to measure them all one by one, takes you a full day or maybe even more to do it. But accuracy, of course, quite important. If you miss it, then it will not work. So first I will show a little example of a project that we did something about 15 years ago, how we did it back then. In the first step, we just marked the strong points of the ship, the longitudinal frames and the girders. A little bit like this, in the yellow lines with the paint, we just marked the strong frames on the ship. And then the second step, you mark out the footprint, the grillets of the carousel. In this case, with the white lines. You can already see the intersection between the yellow and the white lines. That will be the places that you want to support the cargo. This is me about 15 years ago, with the tool that we used back then, small car with a paintbrush. And when you push the handle, it starts painting. Like you said, you do mark also the lines in the football field. Actually, it worked pretty fine. And at the end, on all the intersection points, you can place the shimming place. And at the same time, people are placing the guides here to positioning the carousel itself later on. And at the end, the picture, an overall view, how it looks at the end. And you see it's about 120 different positions where you have to place the shimming plate. In this case, you see already the deck lightings are on. So at the end of the day, so showing that it really was a full day of work to complete all this. Now back to the present times and how we did it with the HoloLens. But I say, I think it was in September of last year. We don't need to first mark all the lines on the deck and everything, because everything will be directly projected by the HoloLens. And you can just walk around and place the shimming plates where the HoloLens shows you where you have to put them. But that's what you see here. You see me walking with a plate, I place it there. Yeah, a little bit paint, and so I give it 10 seconds for one plate. I mean, this is why in total 110 plates for this carousel. I did it in a little bit more than an hour, I think 1.5 hours. All the plates, all the positions were marked and numbered. And then again, when you excuse me, an overview picture, all the shim plates in position. With another overview picture like this. Here to show, finally placing the grillets on top, and you see in the two red circles, the shimming plates exactly on the position where we wanted them. And also the next one showing even better, three positions, also with the curved shape of the grillets. You see that everything, all the shimming plates were just perfectly in the position. So also showing that the accuracy of the HoloLens really works pretty good in this project. In the end, quickly, a summary for the advantages that I really like about working with the HoloLens. First of all, the working speed, like in this example, 15 years ago, it took almost a full day to work it out, and now I can do everything in a little bit more than an hour. What really is nice that the visual check that everything is projected, like Sita showed in the beginning. You see also the girders and the D-rings and everything, the manholes, everything projected. So as long as you see that all these points are projected exactly spot on where you are, that indicates that all the rest what you're doing for the marking also is exactly on the right position. Also pretty good is the flexibility with the OneDrive cloud system. Right? People can work in the office or yourself in your hotel. You can update your drawing, upload it, and when you go to the ship, just once download it in the internal memory of the HoloLens, and you go out on the deck working on a standalone without any Wi-Fi, and everything is there. But also, it's a good benefit. And you can do everything just by yourself. If you have to make a lot of measurements, somebody else has to hold the other end of your tape measure or anything. And this way, you can just do it on your own. The crew can continue with their work, and you don't interfere with each other. Of course, every new technique also has some things that has to be developed. One of the things that we discussed before, the cameras, the sensors are quite sensitive for very bright sunlight and extreme weather conditions like humidity. Then you see that the accuracy is really going down a little bit. Another thing that it's not yet possible to automatically correct when the ship is moving. That's more in the software, and maybe we can upgrade it and make it work. But now we still manually have to correct it ourselves, which is possible, but not yet perfect. And it's now you have to work on one hatch at the same time. So when you have a bigger footprint over cargo and you move to the next hatch, you have to first download and switch to another picture and put your markers again. I can only say for the future, the processors will be bigger and stronger, more memory. And at the end, I think it will be for sure it will be possible that the whole ship is in one projection and everything will go a lot smoother. But that the future will come automatically, I'm sure. This is for so far my part of the presentation.
Oh, well, thank you very much. Well, that's fascinating. That's a great mm-hmm. review from different angles of what we're looking at. So already have quite a lot of questions. I think Joost has answered four of the technical questions, and there's five questions he hasn't answered, which he's left for Sita and Otto to answer more about the shipping company. Maybe we'll start with these open ones first. So I don't know, how do you ensure the source drawings are accurate to the ship configuration? The emission concerns, I think, EMI is electromagnetic interference. Is any electromagnetic interference with the Wi-Fi? Have you considered any mixed reality other than HoloLens? Do you plan to extend your use of mixed reality, and do you have a budget for that? What's your concerns about explosion ATEX with the HoloLens, and a recommendation you try another product there? Maybe should we go to Sita first? I don't know which one of those questions you'd like to, bit of a choice where you'd like to start.
I think I start with the first one. How do you ensure that the source drawings are accurate to the current ship configuration? Well, most of our projects are, well, basically all of our projects are engineered projects, and especially when the HoloLens will come into play, we have big complicated cargo. So for general cargo, this will not be used, and then it's more up to the port captain or the chief officer what to place where. But for most of our cargoes, we'll make anyway a very detailed drawings of how to lift it, how to see fast the cargo, and then we always, for everything, we have to ensure that it's all correct, and the captain or the port captain will check on arrival in the load port if indeed the cargo is as it is according to drawings. And if it's not, then we get a message. But mostly it is. And then I think, I know Joost answered already some, but I'd like to come back on a few of those.
The answer tab,
Because the torsion forces on the vessel during loading, the hatch covers are basically a little bit free to move. I will not say they are completely free to move. They are, of course, they have their securing system, but they will not have a torque itself. Once there is already a a load on top, then yeah, you might actually hear that the hatch covers are moving a little bit. So yeah, it does not have a lot of influence, because we're not talking about 10 centimeters or so, by far not, no. And we did not want to have any additional markers, also not higher up, because they are always on the wrong spot. They are always at a place where you either swing your cargo around or you have to place it. So everything which we would fix on deck, it will always end up in an inconvenient spot.
Well, we've got some questions with some upvotes in the open screen. So asking about the AATEX approval, David Thompson is with Aviva, which is a structural software company. He's asking if you've got a 3D model of the vessel. I guess you must do, but the interference with the Wi-Fi. Do you want to? I don't know which of you is best to take those ones. Do you want to?
Will you take some?
Yeah, no, this one, for a 3D model of the vessel. We do have a 3D model that we use for presentations. But for working like this, I think the ship is still too big. I think Joost can confirm to have the whole ship in the full scale in the 3D model. That's not workable for the moment yet. I think Joost, you can confirm with that one.
Yeah, I like to add to that it's actually, it doesn't really help with the process. We use mixed reality. We already have the real ship under our feet. We don't need a virtual ship. It actually may only be in the way and negatively affecting the performance of the HoloLens and thus accuracy, and accuracy is paramount. We're not making it. Well, the application is very pretty, but it's not a game. It's the goal is to be accurate, and that's the only thing that actually counts. So no, it really didn't have any benefit to add a model to this setup. It's not the goal, it's not the idea.
There might be a question about how you plan the loading itself rather than the actual virtual reality, mixed reality part of it though. I mean, you must have some kind of model that works out where you can put stuff on the deck and tells you if the deck is strong enough.
Ah, but that's what the engineering part, that's already happening at the, if you remember my drawing, with that was the very left part where Sita and our friends who do some very arcane things with AutoCAD, that I've seen drawings that make your hair rise. They put the most crazy and heavy things on top of ship, but we only come into place when that is already done. That process is actually not changed, apart from the fact that they don't have to fly over to Singapore with large hand drawings. They just put the stuff on OneDrive and it automatically gets there.
Yes, that's a very good point you make, Joost. This is completely on the end of the engineering phase. We will not make these drawings in the beginning or somewhere in between. This is just basically the output which we will make only just prior loading. And of course, we base it on calculations made in the earlier engineering phase of deck strength.
Wow.
And glass checks with other cargo, for example.
Well, what about the ATEX approval? Is that an issue for you that you have to worry about? Or if it's stuff on offshore oil rigs, you're not allowed to, everything's got to be, it means you can't make a single spark out of any electrical device on the deck. Well, it sounds like you haven't had to worry about that, is it? Or...
No, up till now we did not worry about that. No.
Okay. Otto, do you want to answer this question about, do you expect to extend your use of mixed reality? Have you allocated a budget? Is that a... I imagine you don't want to talk about budgets, but do you want to say where you're going from now?
No, like I say, I'm not really into the budgets. But yeah, we are still investigating also for new ideas. Eh? This deck marking application is the first idea that we had. And now that it's a success, yes, we are thinking of other applications that also could work. Yeah. For sure, this is not the end.
Yeah. And what about this question about interference with the Wi-Fi on the board, the deck? Is that something that's been a concern? Or the EMC, EMI question, electromagnetic interference? No?
The HoloLens is not connected to any Wi-Fi when you're on the deck. So the only place where interference can happen is where Wi-Fi is, which is on the bridge, I think, or the not exactly how you call the steering house, whatever. So no, it doesn't work. That's not the problem.
Wow. And this question from Herman, I think that's for Otto again. So you talked earlier about the time it takes you to put the lines on the deck with the traditional method. Do you want to give some sort of ideas about the return on investment for this? I don't know how much you're able to say for Herman Schutter's question.
For the whole project to make it work, I think, Joost, we have been working on it more than a year. I think 1 year and a half to get it working. So for that part, it was an investment to start with it. But like the project that I show with this carousel, I think it's paying off. And if you win the time with that one at the end, it really looks good.
Wow. And Jamie, I think this is a question for Joost then. So about the anchors being in inconvenient spots. Oh, that's what you mentioned about the difficulty aligning the digital image with the real world. You could have put that's Satsumas, your specific recentering anchors. The Satsumas in the parking spot. Is that you could put in anchors yourself? Is it?
Oh, no. I understand the idea Jamie suggests, but the rails are not always fixed. So we don't use fixed markers. I mean, the marker is a thing like this. Oops. This is what the engineer uses. He or she points the red end to this is where I want to have the spot. I found this in my bookshelves. I didn't even know I had it anymore. And like Sita said, sometimes stuff will be in the wrong place. You can never use fixed markers. They will go missing. They will weather. They will whatever. And put them on handrails. Then you also have to take into account that the thing is above the ground. As we start to project the drawing, we assume the deck is flat. It may be angled, but it's still flat. If you start to put markers on different heights, there's only pain in there. There's also a question about using more than two fixed points on the ship. Yeah, that doesn't really help. The whole ship rolls. So if I heels, sorry. Or stamps. I mean,
you're on mute. Lost your sound.
I just kept the space bar, but apparently just temporary. So we stuck with the two anchors also because that simply was enough. Yeah, if the ship start moving very rapidly, then I think even ordinary deck marking facilities with the device that Otto showed would get in trouble. So no, we stick to 2 points and we stick to picking stuff on the deck.
Oh, I like this question from Peter Verheyen about, is it comfortable to wear a HoloLens for a longer period? I think I read an article once about it's much more uncomfortable for women than men. I don't know if Sita, you'd like to take that one, is it?
I cannot compare, can I? the first one, indeed, it was a little bit heavy on the front, so you really have to get used to it. I don't know if you will be able to see, because I have one here. It's connected to a helmet, so this one is already better. But this is also still the first HoloLens. And like with the HoloLenses, I hope it goes with the iPhones, the development. But I think for the second one, Joost has one now, the weight is already better divided on the front than the aft. So indeed, you really had to get used to it a bit. And after really long time, 2 hours or so, it really get uncomfortable. But then I hope, after 2 hours, you can take a little break, I suppose.
Okay, I've got an office fire alarm in my building, so I'm going to have to hand the chairing over to Vida now. Nice to see you.
Okay, so let's continue with the questions until Carl is back. He had to evacuate from his building. Okay, do you see any questions that we have still quite interesting questions here from David, Nils, or Michael? Is there someone, for example, this to deal with rotation problem, roll and stamps, have you thought about using two or more fixed points on the ship?
Yeah, I just answered that. I see also still a question from David. He was related to the accuracy of the drawings, but the actual accuracy of the drawings, that's already been taken care of for a long time. That's I think, what Sita and her colleagues have been doing for, since time immemorial almost. That part is, the drawings itself are accurate. It's only the task to project them accurately on the deck. The deck plate, the hatch cover. Lingo is coming back. So I hope now, David, your question is answered. Doing that in 3D makes things only more complex.
Mm-hmm. Also, Michael is asking if he simply wants a clarification to scan the whole ship first. How does this calibration take?
Actually, we take... We have divided the vessel in separate parts, and the most obvious ones being the hatch covers, so the upper deck hatch covers. They're mostly 8 or 9 per vessel, and then the tween decks and the tank top is also divided in several parts. So if you have to do the marking, you will do one by one. It's like you have a book with all your drawings, and you take first the page with... the hatch cover number 4, which you need to be on deck. And in the HoloLens is the same. You first click, you select hatch cover 4, and then you select hatch cover 5. So you will not have to scan the whole ship first. It's just that one hatch cover. So you'll walk over it, which you anyway have to do because you have to get the reference points on port side aft and starboard forward. So it's only a matter of 2 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Okay, there's also Hans Hayen is asking, how much time do you save on average during loading? I guess that's for auto.
Yeah, that depends a lot. I think for some cargoes, I think you will not win any time if it's just a matter of just marking one or two lines to get a cargo in position. Then I would say working with the HoloLens is not making it faster. That was the example that I showed with this carousel with all the shim plates. I think that's the perfect example where we have a lot of time win. And there it was compared to a full day of work, so 8-10 hours reduced to only 1 hour, 1 hour and a half. Of course, many projects in between. I like the picture that Sita showed in the beginning for one of the projects. Also for this one, with a lot of cargo placed diagonally or around shapes, which is very difficult to measure just by hand. I think there indeed you will win a lot of time with this method.
Okay, interesting. Paul Garish is asking, and is probably giving some kind of tip for your future. So if this becomes your standard process, are you going to design a few reference points on each of the ship to make everything faster? Is it possible?
I think for now we keep I think for now we keep it to the hatch covers.
Yeah, a little bit delay, I think.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Also, because you don't need to have, let's say, the whole deck every time. Sometimes it's really local. And we could consider if the HoloLens will also be developed further, that it has a larger reach. Then we could consider it, because that's anyway just a matter of some numbers changing in our printing settings and in the settings of the DMS procedure of cutting the picture into all these tiles. So it's something we can always consider and always can change by ourselves in a few hours. But for now, I think we stick to the hatch covers.
Yeah, because it's also a practical problem that we also ran into, that actually hatch covers can be changed around. So that is also an interesting thing. So if you put fixed markers on hedge covers and those are then just shuffled around, then you can get some very unwanted results. So it's actually okay. The deck marker who decides which deck is which deck.
Okay. We kind of in the invitation, we mentioned that there will be like a demonstration, but I later learned from you that the demonstration of this software and how everything works would be a bit impossible in the webinar to do. So can you give a few words maybe what, for example, the live demonstration, how it could be done, or maybe you can again go through a little bit showing these glasses and what's possible to do with them.
I've done some demos on seminars and also on exhibitions in Rotterdam. And basically what I do is that I will give the HoloLens to the person wearing interested. And I'm not sure if it fits over my things, the ear thing, so I'll just take it off. But yeah, how it would look like is that you see somebody else. Put it on. And then that person is going to crawl over the ground. And everybody else is looking at what's that person doing. And yeah, that's I can't really demonstrate it here. It would also not be much nicer for you than to see this. So
I'm just curious, for example, for the person who is putting it for the first time and actually has to draw to use it, how much maybe time or effort does it take to learn, how this software is behaving and how to properly use it?
No, that doesn't take too much time already. Many of my colleagues gave them an instruction. I think with an explanation of 5, maybe 10 minutes, and they're practicing a little bit. I think in total, in 15 minutes, I think a person can work with it. Also, the menu structure, how Joost programmed the menus, is very self-explaining. So it's not that complicated. No.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think we exhausted all the questions from the audience. Congratulations, you answered more than 20 questions altogether. And now for the closing, is there something each of you would like to say, like a few closing words, having implemented this project?
I, for myself, I can say I'm very proud to have been part of this, to actually pull this off, and very happy to see it's actually being used, because in this world, a lot of companies are just making proof of concepts and stuff like that and making a lot of noise with it, but actually not amounting to much. And I really like that Jumbo had the guts and the insight just to go through with it. And now they're reaping the rewards.
Thank you. Sita?
I also want to thank Joost for being here, because not being part of Jumbo, it's really nice that he helped to explain this to all of you. And also, we like, as Jumbo, we like to show what we're doing, because we think it's worth showing, and we want to develop it further. We want to use it much more often, continue with it, and indeed get more and more and more benefits from it. And also, if there are other companies which are really interested, please let us know.
Yeah. Thank you, Sita. Otto, few words from your side.
Yeah, from my side, the same as for the other two. It was very nice working on this project, and especially the example that I showed with this carousel. It really gave me good pleasure to see how fast everything was working, and that indeed I saw the benefit of working with the HoloLens, as we expected. That in reality, indeed, it also works like that, and that was really good. And yeah, for the last question there, for a live demo, indeed, very difficult. in a webinar to do like this, but maybe we can send people some links to some YouTube posts made by Jumbo, where you can see a little bit more.
Okay,
maybe right. After this session, I think you sent to the audience anyway, send a link to the YouTube pages, and then people can see a little bit more mm-hmm. how it really works.
Okay, great idea. We will try to put all the materials after the webinar to everyone. And now, thank you very much for all of you joining and sparing this hour with us, asking questions. Many of the attendees are coming from technology development side as well. So please leave your feedback in the survey. Tell us more if you would like to hear more webinars on maintenance. And on Thursday, we're inviting you to join us again and hear about the way to provide modern television for crew to relax on ships. And now I'm thankful to our speakers, and Digital Ship is signing off. Take care.
Okay. Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.